Hi, today we're going to look at how to install Microsoft SQL Server 2012. SQL Server 2012, or Denali as it was called before the launch, is Microsoft's latest database offering. SQL 2012 is a major release as far as Microsoft is concerned, since the previous version SQL 2008 R2. A lot of the features that we have been used to in SQL 2008 R2 have been improved, and a considerable number of new features have also been added. Some of these include Always On, which is Microsoft's latest high availability solution, as well as data quality services, and a number of other important features that would be helpful from a BI or business intelligence standpoint. Let's go ahead now and start the installation process, and we will discuss some of these important features as we progress through the installation. If you downloaded the installer from the internet or the Microsoft website, then you're likely to see something similar to these three files here. These are packaged files, so the expectation is that we go ahead and unpack them to get a folder similar to what you see here. If you open up the folder, you should see something similar to what's there on screen right now. And as you can see, there's a lot of it is similar to what we would be used to in SQL Server 2008 R2 as well. So let's go ahead now, double click the setup.exe file and begin the installation process. For the most part, the installation process is very similar to what you would see in SQL 2008 R2, and it is quite intuitive in terms of being able to go ahead and perform the installation without a lot of planning or without a lot of know-how into what needs to go into it. However, there are a few things that you'd need to pay attention to, and that's what we will focus on as part of this demonstration. As you can see, we've got the same standard set of options in the installation center, and let's go ahead and click on the system configuration checker, which is a tool that will help us identify whether the hardware or the components that we have installed on this desktop or laptop or server is sufficient to help with the successful completion of the installation. If you click show details, you'll see that there are a couple of prerequisite checks that it needs validated before you can go ahead with installation. So everything looks good. We've passed all these scenarios that the system configuration checker would validate. Having done that, now if you click on the installation button here, you'll see that we have the same set of options that we have from SQL 2008 R2 as well. So let's go ahead and install a new instance of SQL Server by clicking on the link New SQL Server Standalone Instance or Installation, or add features to an existing installation. As you can see, we have a support rules screen that's actually going ahead and performing certain checks as far as the prerequisites before the installation starts. For example, the computer should not have any restarts pending, and .NET framework, etc. So these are some additional checks that need to be done as part of the installation process, and as you can see, we've passed all of them, so I think we're good to go. So let's go ahead and press OK. I am installing SQL on my laptop, so the performance of or the speed of the installation might be significantly lower than what you would see when you install on a hardware set on a server that's a more powerful hardware configuration. Again, as you can see here, I've got the evaluation edition that I've downloaded from the internet or from the Microsoft website, so I'm just gonna leave evaluation edition here. If you have the purchased or licensed version of it, you can go ahead and select enter the product key and then type in the product key. Press next. Again, you have to accept the license terms. It might be a good idea for you to read through this just so that you understand what the support boundaries are regarding the software that you've just purchased. And press next. At this point, it is actually performing certain operations that would not really be part of the installation of SQL Server 2012, but more importantly, additional files that will help process or go through the installation successfully. So this might take a second, so let's just give it some time. Once the setup process is complete, or once the support file installation process is complete, you should see something similar to this. The files that were installed previously have some rules that need to be verified, which is what we see here in terms of prerequisites and checks that need to be validated before the installation. So looks like we're good to go here. Press next. Again, this is the first time I'm installing SQL Server on this machine, so I'll go ahead and select SQL Server feature installation. Now you also have some other version or other ability or features that's available with SQL Server, such as SQL Server Power Pivot for SharePoint. These are some other BI related features that you might want to install if you have SharePoint Server configured. For our scenario, we're just going to stick with the normal SQL Server installation, so select the first option and then press next. So here we see a list of the features that come with SQL Server 2012, and for the most part, a lot of these options are similar to what you would see in SQL 2008 R2 as well. For example, you've got the database engine service, and then you got replication and full text. However, you might have noticed that you have a new one called data quality services here as well. These are some of the new features that we have with SQL Server. So let's go ahead and select database engine service and data quality services. I'll not be installing analysis services or reporting services for the moment. So I'll just say data quality client, data tools, client tools, integration. I'm going to go ahead and install all the shared features because they are a one-time installation and not really instance dependent. So I'm selecting them just so that I don't have to do it at a later point in time. So as you can see, we have not really installed replication or full text, and we're not installing analysis services or reporting services for the time being. In fact, let's go ahead and install reporting services for this particular installation, and I'll be showing a few videos at a later point in time on how to use reporting services with SQL 2012. So let's go ahead and press next. Again, a lot of validations, a lot of checks that need to be performed. If you click the View Details tab, you can see that there's a lot of description and messages that you can use in terms of being able to identify if there are some things that you need to do before the installation can progress successfully. Coming back to the actual installation, you see that prior Visual Studio 2010 instance requiring update. Nope, all good. So let's go ahead and press next. I already have a Microsoft SQL Server default instance, which is a SQL 2008 R2 instance, as you can see here, 10.51.2500 developer edition. So I'll need to go ahead and rename or create a named instance of SQL Server 2012 here. So I'm just going to call it SQL 2012. It'll be installed in the default C drive because that's the only disk drive that I have available on my laptop. So everything looks good here. As you can see, we've got two folder locations. One is for the database engine and the other is for reporting services. Installed instances show the previous installation of SQL Server and any other shared components that I might already have. Press next. At this point, it summarizes the disk space requirements, and we obviously have enough space to go ahead with the actual installation, so everything looked good there. So go ahead and press next. At this point, you'll see that we come to a very important screen in the SQL Server installation process, and this is the service account screen. Now, the service account screen is the screen where you would actually create or map logins that will create a startup account for each service. A service will be found under services.msc. If you click start, run, and then type in services.msc, you'll see that it opens up an MMC console, and in the console you'll have a list of services for different applications that are running on the server. So I've got quite a few, and if you look, I've already got SQL Server 2008 R2 installed, and I have some services associated with it. A key thing to remember with service accounts is that the service account decides how secure or how robust your installation is. It's not a good idea to have an administrator account as the service account, for obvious reasons, because your SQL Server database installation doesn't really need an administrator account in order to start the service. The service that you would use, or the account that you would use to start a service, would generally just require permissions to the program files folder where the SQL binaries are installed, and any additional drives for data, backups, etc. It might also require registry and logon as a service, and a few other permissions depending on what you're trying to achieve. And that should pretty much be the only permissions that should be assigned to the startup account. Another thing that you might want to do is go ahead and make sure that you always use a domain authenticated account as a startup service account. Do not use local system accounts or network account like what we have here, anti-service, etc., because that's not a good practice. At this point, my laptop is not connected to a domain, so I don't really have the option of specifying a different account. So I'll stick with what the defaults are available over here. And another thing that you might want to notice is that by default, only the database engine, reporting services, and integration services have automatic startup. You can also see that the SQL browser service also has an automatic startup. You would normally go ahead and disable this because the SQL Server browser service might not be required when you're setting up your SQL Server instance on a data center. Another important thing that you might want to do as a DBA is validate the collation of the SQL Server instance. In this case, I'm using the default Latin General 1 case insensitive accent insensitive. Traditionally, as you can see with previous offerings of Microsoft SQL Server, you have two different types of collation. You got the Windows collation and you got the SQL Server collation. The SQL Server collation is mainly meant for backward compatibility, and if you are migrating from a newer version of SQL Server, you should probably just be using the Windows collation unless you have a specific requirement. Choosing the wrong collation during the installation process can severely affect how development is done at a later point in time. A lot of the features and functionality that you might want to use at a later point in time may behave unexpectedly just because of the fact that there's the wrong collation. So before you actually decide on what collation you need to use, it might be a good idea to talk to business owners and developers to identify the requirement that they have with this particular system. Clicking on next, you'll see that the next screen is a server configuration screen. At this point, we want to go ahead and use both Windows authentication as well as mixed mode or SQL Server authentication. So let me just go ahead and put in a password here, just a second. Okay, the server configuration here is basically related to security. At this point, what I'm doing is I'm identifying or defining the administrators for this particular installation of SQL Server 2012. Unlike previous instances of SQL Server, you need to actually specifically define the Windows account. Previously, members of the administrator role on the operating system were automatically added as administrators in SQL Server as well. However, this is no longer the case, so you need to click Add Current User, or add and then specify the username of the next user that you want to go ahead and bind as an administrator. By selecting mixed mode, what I've done is I've enabled the SA account and specified a password for that as well. The data directories, as you can see, is just the default folder locations for different components that we would be installing today. We've got obviously the data root directory, and then we've got the system database directories, which is the database directory for databases like master, temp, model, etc. The data root directory, the one that you see above, is where the binaries for SQL Server would be installed. In addition, you have two dedicated folders or two dedicated paths that you can assign for user-created database MDF files and NDF files and user-created log files. The reason for this is because these two files have different characteristics in terms of input and output on the disk, and therefore, if you do have the option to split the I/O operation on your disk RAID levels, then you would need to probably change these locations to reflect accordingly. A similar logic applies with the tempdb as well, and the tempdb is a common database or a transient data store where you would create a lot of temporary objects that will disappear after the session or when the execution of the particular code is completed. And because of the special nature of this database and the fact that this is a common repository for all other databases in the server, you might want to go ahead and split the location of the temp directory as well. In addition to this, you can see that we also have a folder for backups. FileStream is the Microsoft capability where you can actually store physical files on the disk drive and have them maintain integrity within the database itself. You can do that by enabling FileStream here. At this moment, we're not looking at FileStream. I will be doing a separate video on FileStream later. So let's go ahead and press next. Again, when you have reporting services, you get the option where you can either just install reporting services or install and configure it. So let's go ahead and just leave it at install and configure the default for the moment, and then press next. Distributed replay controller is a new feature in SQL Server, so let's go ahead and add a user for that as well, and then press next. The controller name is something that you need to define at the time of installing SQL Server itself. So I'm just going to call it DC1 for the moment. In fact, I'm going to call it DRC1 because DC1 could also mean data collectors, which is another feature inside SQL Server. So go ahead and just press next. And we're almost done with the basic configuration of the installation process. So let's go ahead and just press next at this moment. A couple of other warnings based on selection that we've done so far. So everything looks good at this point. Let's go ahead and press next. So in this screen, what you see is a summary of all the steps that we've performed so far. It basically identifies the components that have been installed so far, the services or components that we are likely or we are expected to install at this moment, and then some basic information about the configuration or the options that we've selected so far, such as the folder structure and the accounts, etc. So this is pretty much what we need to do in terms of actually configuring or telling the instance or the setup file what needs to be installed and how exactly. A key thing that you might want to remember here is that it creates something called a configuration file, and this configuration file would be very useful when you're trying to perform unattended installations of SQL Server on other machines as well. So it's generally a good idea to go to this location and take a copy of this file so that you can reuse it when you're required to install SQL Server on different machines. So with that, we're actually done telling SQL Server setup file what needs to be done. So let's just go ahead now and press install and begin the installation process. The actual installation process does take some amount of time, so I'm going to go ahead and just let it run and come back to you when the installation is almost complete. As you can see, we are almost done with the installation process. Just a few more minutes and we are good to go. Cool. So if you look at the screen now, you'll see that you've got a summary of pretty much all the steps that have been performed and whether all the components that we were trying to install have been installed successfully. Looks like pretty much everything is installed successfully, so that's good. And if you scroll down, you'll see that there are some additional information about post-installation things that you might want to do as far as SQL Server is concerned. If you're looking for information in detail about what the whole installation has actually done, you can click on this particular link, which is just a summary of the actual installation process. And if you click it, it opens up a text file which gives you information about what was installed and pretty much any other information regarding any particular comments that the installation process might have returned in terms of what happened. So this is all there is really to installing SQL Server. At this point, now we need to validate whether the installation has gone through successfully. So if you click on Start and then go to All Programs and then go to SQL Server 2012 and open up Management Studio, we should be able to see if you're able to connect to the database engine. Right off the bat, you might notice that the interface for SQL Server 2012 is different compared to that of SQL 2008 R2. It's more of a Visual Studio kind of interface, and that consolidates or tries to combine a lot of the advantages that you got with SQL Server with Visual Studio into the SQL Server environment. The look and feel of it, while being familiar, does not really impede your ability to work with SQL Server, as a lot of the features that you see is very similar to what you already have in SQL 2008 R2. So let's go ahead and say SQL 2012. I'm using Windows Authentication. I press Connect. And there we go. So looks like we've installed SQL Server successfully. If you click New Query and then select Add Server, you should be able to go ahead and identify if this installation has gone through successfully. A key thing that you might have noticed after installation of SQL Server is that it did not really ask you to restart the server. There we go. And that's how you would install SQL Server 2012. I hope you've enjoyed this video and look forward to seeing you soon.